And all of you should be thankful to her as well. Not only does she do a hell of a job, but she's the one that was responsible for helping me set this interview up between me and Leuren, and introducing me to Leuren. So big thank you to Christina. And she's actually the co-pilot for the interview. And you'll hear her in there. She does a lot of the talking. No need for me to interrupt her. She's the expert I go to, right? So anyway, big thank you to Christina. So I want to play that interview about the half hour mark, because it's a little bit, it's about an hour long, and I want to I want to start at about the half hour mark. That way, if going into the second hour, if I have to rewind it a little bit, I can, and then I have some time to go over into the final segment with it. So before I get into the interview, I want to talk to you a little bit about Fukushima, and then I want to talk to you about the animal die-offs. I know Fukushima seems scary, ladies and gentlemen. I know the idea of an ELE, which is an end-life event, right? End-of-life event, destruction of humanity to a certain level. I know that sounds kind of scary. I don't think, if left unchecked, yeah, it will kill all of us. I think it will affect us no matter what, and I think future generations need to know about it so they can at least mitigate the damage that's done. Sticking your head in the sand and ignoring it and going, la la la, radiation doesn't affect me, is not really going to solve the problem. Now, there's no point in running from it and being afraid of it. Fukushima is a reality. I know a lot of people in the alternative media are like, no, that's just fear-mongering. There's nothing wrong over in Japan. Oh, there's a lot wrong going on in Japan, and there's a lot wrong on the West Coast here in the United States. So we have to face it. Do you run from your problems in life, ladies and gentlemen, in your personal life? Do you run from all your problems and stick your hand in the sand? Or wouldn't you rather know there's an issue so you could deal with it? If your house had something wrong with it, would you rather just not know and pretend that there was nothing wrong and the problem gets persistently worse until the house falls down around your ears? Or would you rather know that there's an issue so you can handle it so the house doesn't fall down around your ears? Should I cue the Jeopardy music? I don't think you need 7 seconds to figure that one out. So that's what Fukushima is. Our house has a major problem with it. Our house being the Earth. You know, I'm asked, why wouldn't the mainstream media pick up on this and use this to scare the crap out of everybody? Honestly, because I think Fukushima is one of those events that it would bring down, if everybody actually focused on it, it would bring down this whole one world government or dark one world government, tyrannical government idea. Because they need division and separation in order to have that, because they need that to foment divide. And trust me, they'll still use division and separation even after they get their little one world government. They need that. Fukushima is one of those events that kind of makes you realize that politics is bullshit. Kind of makes you realize that hating somebody because they're black, white, Latino, Asian is bullshit. It makes you realize that hating somebody because they're Republican or Democrat or gay or straight or whatever, you realize it's all bullshit. Because none of that matters if we're all getting bathed in radiation and this shit show over in Japan is not being handled properly. And I'm being bluntly honest with you because you need somebody to talk to you like this and tell you the way it is. There's no need to be upset about it or afraid of it. It is what it is. You being afraid of it is not going to make the problem any better. You having, anxiety attacks or, you know, flip out sessions or whatever, you know, over Fukushima because you're scared of it is not going to solve the problem. Listening to calm, rational people like Christina or Leuren, or the other gentleman that you'll hear on tonight, Lorenz, the three of them, listen to them calmly, cool, collectively. They're not flipping out. They know what the deal is. Look, sticking your head in the sand and going la, 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 doesn't stop you from being affected by it. So you're still going to be affected, right? So if that's the case, and no matter what you do, you're still affected by it, shouldn't you try to do the best possible thing? Shouldn't you have the best possible reaction to it that you could possibly have instead of freaking out or being in fear? Because it doesn't solve anything, at least if you try to operate in the other side of things, from the other side of the spectrum, with some love and some knowledge and some logic, and not allow the fear to take over you, we can handle this. Look, ladies and gentlemen, let me be curt with you and very frank. We all die. If there's one thing I've learned in the past year, it's that we all die. And I knew that already, but we all go. Young, old, it's the one fact of life that none of us can escape. Some people may not be able to, you know, get caught. Maybe they do things and they get away with, you know, robbing a place or whatever. You know, some of us may not have to pay taxes. Some of us may not have to pay for tolls because they don't ride in cars or whatnot. So they only take bicycles and they don't have to, you know, take a toll expressway or whatnot, you can avoid certain things, you know, taxes, sometimes tolls, maybe even tickets or whatnot. Death is one of those things that you can't avoid. So, since you can't avoid it, we all have to face it one day, it's an inevitability, right? Wishing it away, wanting it away, hoping it doesn't happen is not going to happen. We all die. So understanding that, you shouldn't have any fear of it anymore. It's just as much a part of your experience as living is. Once you understand that, you don't fear death anymore. And you learn to live your life to the fullest while you're here. And you learn to live your life in the best possible way and to make your life count while you're here. Everybody freaks out about dying. Nobody really worries about how they live. And that's what we really should be doing, is worrying about how we live. And part of that is responding to situations in real world, bad, scary things like Fukushima and how we deal with it. Does it suck that that thing is leaking and spewing radiation? Yes, it does. It's horrible. It can be frightening, ladies and gentlemen. But you know what? Like I said, there's really nothing to fear, is there? Because we all make that transition one day. So if you can deal with that and if you can accept that, you can get beyond your fear of death, and then you'll be willing to face things differently. Trust me. But you have to actually realize it and accept it yourself. You can't just listen to me tell you. You have to look inside yourself. You have to decide that you want to be the change. You have to actually walk the walk and not just talk the talk. So with that in mind, ladies and gentlemen, when you look at Fukushima, do not be afraid, because we can handle this. Look, some of us, some of our generation, and I mean millions of people worldwide, the older generations, people in their 30s and 40s, it's probably too late for us. There's a lot of us who have probably gotten lifespans shortened. Maybe we won't live to be, you know, in our 80s or 90s. Maybe we'll only live to be in our 60s or 70s now because of Fukushima. And who knows if it keeps going, how low that will drop. But what about your grandkids? What about your grandkids, the children that aren't even born yet? You may have a 2 or 3 year old grandchild. You still look at them like a babe Popeye. I don't want to think about them having children. They're too young for that. But you should think about their grandchildren is what you should be thinking about, because that is your spawn too. You should be thinking 10 steps ahead. Ladies and gentlemen, that should concern you. You should be worried about the future of the planet. What kind of planet we leave for future generations. That should be motivation enough for you right there. And no, it's not all doom and gloom. Yes, radiation's bad, but look, there's things that can be done. We're just not doing them. I'm not saying it's going to make it go away. We now have to learn to live with this reality, but maybe we should have learned to deal with this, 4 years ago? I mean, this thing's just, it's a machine. Christina described it best. It's just a radiation-spewing monster that's non-stop. It's just going. The on switch is broken in the on position, and it's not going in the off position anytime soon. And we need to come up with a way to deal with it. I have news for you, by the way. TEPCO admits that they don't even have technology currently that would be sufficient to clean it up and deal with it. The same TEPCO that you thought, by the way, that had all this problem solved, and, oh, don't worry, these Fukushima fear mongers. You know what? Yeah, unfortunately, there were some people in the alternative media that took advantage of the situation and went out and bought large quantities of iodine and then sold it. Okay. And you know what? That's not everybody. That's not everybody that does this and talks about it. A lot of the people that do this and speak about Fukushima don't make any money. They get nothing in return other than trying to bring you some factual information. Yes, just like with anything, when you look into Fukushima, just like with 9/11 or JFK, you will find some misinformation or disinformation. TEPCO's out there putting up tons of it. It's going to happen. Be rational, be calm. Try to listen and pay attention to the people that are reporting the truth and that you can verify what they say. Don't just read a headline and go, oh my God. And by the way, you shouldn't do that with anything. That's part of the problem with Facebook and Twitter. People don't even read the articles. They read the headline and then tweet it out or retweet it or whatever, and or post it on Facebook, you know, repost or to a group or to a page or whatever. They don't even read the article. They only post it specifically based off of the title. That's not the way to be, ladies and gentlemen. Come on, we're better than that. In alternative media, we need you people to step up to the plate. My fellow compatriots here in the alternative media, where are you? I know not all of you are fools. Come on. There's a lot of smart people out there. Don't be afraid to be called a fearmonger because you look into Fukushima. Radiation's a real problem. Maybe we should be a little bit more worried about it. maybe if you were paying attention more to it, you'd see that TEPCO has absolutely zero control over what's going on over there right now. That alone should be a very sobering thought. Japan passed a secrecy law. You can't talk about what goes on at Fukushima or you could go to jail. That's not shady. What is that, to curb conspiracy theories? Bullshit. It's to hide what's going on. Let's be honest. Fukushima should be something that alarms you. No, you don't need to run around like a chicken with its head cut off and screaming, oh my God. But you do need to pay attention. You do need to know what's going on. You need to know the details. We need to know how much radiation we're being exposed to. There's machines that different universities had all over that did, that played with nukes or did, you know, nuke testing or, you know, that kind of science and stuff. And all over the country they had, and I forget what they're called. Christina would know. They were machines that basically tested the amount of radiation in a given substance, whether it be, you know, you put a piece of metal in there, you put a piece of dead animal or meat, cup of milk, whatever. And it would test and tell you the amount of radiation, I forget what they're called, but it would tell you the amount of radiation and what type was in there. Well, after Fukushima, the government came and picked all those machines up from all the universities that had them. So nobody has them anymore. Why would they do that? Wouldn't you, after a nuke event, a criticality, whatever happened over there, wouldn't you want that stuff so you could bring samples in of tuna and animals that are dying off on the West Coast like now and give them to these universities to study to see what's in their tissue? But you can't because all these universities have had their stuff taken away. Now, I know people that have sent or tried to find universities to send stuff to get dead animals or other things that they're trying to get sampled to see the right levels of radiation in it. And they were told this by these different universities. We can't test it because the government, the federal government, came and took our equipment after the Fukushima event. You don't think that's shady, ladies and gentlemen? How about the fact that they upped the acceptable levels of radiation in your food and in your water and in the air and in the soil? Yeah, after Fukushima, the United States government responded to the event by raising the acceptable limits of radiation in your food, water, air, and the ground. And you, basically. That should give you pause. So they don't care. And yeah, they're going to tell you it doesn't affect us. I haven't seen the news talk about it. Yeah, you know, they're not testing for it. Canada turned off their meters. I don't even think we're monitoring our meters at this point. A couple years ago, I did a show. A couple of years, like 2012, I think it was, or 2013, I did a show about radiated tuna in the Pacific Ocean. And that all the tuna that they were testing was coming back radiated. That's not a conspiracy theory. It's true. I mean, a leaking nuke plant causing problems, this isn't the first time this has happened, so people should be like, well, we don't have any precedent set for this. Oh, I don't know, Chernobyl, Three Mile Island. The list keeps on going. Hello, people. Come on. Seriously. This is an ongoing event. Maybe we should be worried about this than Tom Brady and his friggin' Deflategate. Maybe? Everybody's worried about Tom Brady and a football. Let me ask you a question. Does Tom Brady deflating his football affect your food, water, air, and ground, and your children's lives, and their unborn children's lives, and their unborn children's lives? Does Tom Brady have any effect? No, he doesn't. He doesn't. Tom Brady doesn't have an effect on much of things, apparently. That's why apparently he has to deflate his football to have some, you know, throw it better, whatever the hell was the case, better grip on it. So even your hero is an illusion. You get it? Stop paying attention to that. Pay attention to the real stuff. We need good minds like you out there, ladies and gentlemen. Seriously. Who do you think's going to solve this? Obviously not these idiots over at TEPCO or not our government. And remember, the government's compartmentalized, so it doesn't have to be the whole government just in on it. No, you just have to have it from high up, you know, you do this, and this is, you know, and that's it. And compartmentalization works as easily as this guy, you have, and this guy, all each have an individual job. And each one of those guys only knows what they need to know to get their job done. That's compartmentalization. It's that simple. Maybe they're told by their supervisor, oh, Fukushima is not an issue, and they trust their supervisor. Wouldn't be the first time somebody trusted their boss and was lied to. And it doesn't mean that the boss is lying to them willfully going, ha, 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 I'm going to poison everybody. He's probably buying what he's told to because he's been taught to follow orders and to trust in authority. You see how easy it is to get people to believe anything you want when you're taught to obey authority and follow the logical fallacy of appeal to authority without any question whatsoever? It's amazing what Pavlovian programming can do to us, ladies and gentlemen. So that's why people don't ask. That's why it's so easy to compartmentalize and control. So what we need, and we being the human race, we need you, ladies and gentlemen. I need you. The world needs you to step up and do the right thing and not be afraid of this. Okay? So I want to take a few minutes before I get into the deep, dark, scary Fukushima and what's going on over in the Pacific Ocean to have a reality check with you, so to speak. I'm not ripping that off, Rebecca. TM. I want you to understand that there's no point in running around and being afraid of it and ignoring it because it's scary. It's something that we all have to face. So let's do it with some logic, and let's do it together, and let's figure this out. And like I said before, this would bring down the whole New World Order agenda, because instead of having a controlled event where they could bring something in that they totally control to have their version of a one world government, if everybody realized that this doesn't affect anybody, or excuse me, this affects everybody, and it doesn't, the politics and the separation really don't affect anybody, only if we allow it to, then their game would be over. Their method of control would be gone. Maybe that's one of the reasons they don't talk about Fukushima too much. And then, of course, there's always the monetary factor, all the money, all of the other nuke plants. And then people are going to start asking questions. And then you'll have, like, GE having problems. And then you have military-industrial complex. And so there's a lot of connections. There's a lot of reasons. But I think one of the biggest ones is because they realize that people would realize the totality of the situation. And a lot of these divide and conquer techniques that are used to control us would be out the window. They wouldn't matter. If everybody actually had the realization as to what was really going on, none of that would be important. Again, a shift in perspective. It's that simple. That's how it starts, ladies and gentlemen. A simple shift in perspective. Anyway, we're going to break. Stay tuned. We will be back in 3 short minutes. When we get back, I'm going to get into the interview with Leuren Moret on the West Coast animal die-offs and Fukushima. Stay tuned. I'm going to get into the interview with Leuren in 2 seconds here. First, I want to set it up properly for you all. So we were talking about the Pacific Coast. Well, actually, I had the pleasure of talking to Leuren for like probably almost 5 hours. And it was a very interesting conversation. We talked about many different things. But tonight, I'm only airing the part where we were discussing Fukushima and the West Coast animal die-offs in particular. Because that's the topic for tonight. But she will be doing other interviews with me. An amazing, amazing lady. Very intelligent. Amazingly so. Very interesting and fun to talk to her, to say the least. So I will get to the interview with her in just a second, but I want to set it up properly. So Christina, the last time I spoke to her, we were talking about this Godzilla algae. Remember I spoke about this a couple weeks ago? She sent me a link from ENE News, and it's got actually 3 stories on it, but 2 of them are from the same link, at least on the website they are. I'll drop the link to the ENE News story right now in the truthfrequencyradio.com chat. If you go over to truthfrequencyradio.com and go to chat, I think you go to listen live page, and there's a couple different options. You can find the one with the chat room. And you can go in there and you'll see the link I just dropped. And I'll make sure I post the link in the YouTube archive to this as well. So this, and one of them is from the AP/ABC. Scientist, whale deaths off Alaska Island remains a mystery. So Kodiak, Alaska, they found a bunch of dead whale carcasses. And they're trying to figure out why they washed up on shore and what killed them. And they're not really sure, and they checked back for out in the quote unquote algae blooms that you're going to hear them mention in a second. I'm going to play a little piece of audio, and that you've heard me talk about before, the Godzilla algae episode I did a couple weeks ago again, and you're going to hear Leuren, Christina, Lorenz, and myself all discuss tonight. They keep blaming algae, right? Oh God, it's toxic algae. never look at radiation from Fukushima. Don't even talk about that, but it's toxic algae. Oh, and by the way, the Pacific Ocean is abnormally warm, they've been saying this year. Well, gee, what would heat up water? Oh, radiation. Oh, but don't look at that. No, it's El Nino and global warming, and if we pay money to Al Gore, that'll solve everything, but don't pay attention to Fukushima, and that has no bearing on what's going on in the Pacific whatsoever, right? Okay, so the toxic algae blooms that are, well, the supposed toxic algae blooms, they tested these animals for the toxic algae that's killing all the starfish and giving seals seizures, except there was no toxic algae. So what killed them? Well, it's really hard to tell. They say, the one scientist says, oh, we may never know. Oh, yeah, sure. How much money did you get paid to say that? But they are testing. They actually did mention in ABC, from the AP here, they did actually mention, they say, which surprised me, but they're actually testing to see if there's anything. It says other test results are also pending. However, a muscle tissue sample is being tested for the possibility of radionuclides from the 2011 Fukushima disaster. So at least they're looking into it. But of course, they keep throwing, well, maybe it's sonar testing and maybe it's this. It's if it comes back positive and they say it's Fukushima, I would be highly surprised if the mainstream media admitted it. Even if it is, they'll probably say no because it's controlled. So we have to keep an eye on that. But thinking in the vein of that toxic algae, and I don't think it's toxic algae. I said this before. You're going to hear Christina say this tonight. You're going to hear Loren say this tonight. You're going to hear Lorenz say this tonight. And you'll hear me say it again tonight. None of us think it's toxic algae. Anybody with half a brain in their head shouldn't think it's toxic algae. And even if it was toxic algae, like I said, when I spoke to Christina multiple times about this on air, and like I said on that show, the Godzilla algae episode I did, if it is algae, quote unquote, oh, scary algae, well, maybe we should question why it's suddenly killing things that it never killed. Maybe it's mutated because of radiation. That's not good. That's not good at all. And you'll hear Lorenz talk tonight about how there's algae, they found algae growing around Fukushima. So perhaps algae can adapt to radiation? Well, that's not cool. Maybe you really do have Godzilla algae. And then maybe bacteria can do the same thing. Oh, that wouldn't be good. And then, of course, the starfish are melting. So even if it wasn't the radiation melting them and they weren't getting starfish chemo because of the radiated water and they breathe it in and they use it like blood and stuff. So even if they weren't getting starfish chemo, which they are, wouldn't a mutant bacteria or algae mutated by radiation give you some level of pause? I know it would me. No. Anyway, so the other one, dead fish, wildlife in the Aleutians may be victims of toxic algae outbreak. Here's the mainstream news report, and then I'm going to play the interview from Loren. It's important that you hear this so you get the full interview in full context.
Scientists have been receiving reports of dead and dying whales, birds, and small fish in the Aleutian Islands. They think it might be from toxic algae proliferating due to unusually warm ocean temperatures. KUCB's John Ryan reports.
Bruce Wright with the Aleutian Pribilof Islands Association says all the signs point to the region having a major outbreak of harmful algae. Wright says it could be the algae that caused paralytic shellfish poisoning. The algae that generate domoic acid are another possible culprit. Melissa Good with the University of Alaska Fairbanks has been looking for the microscopic green suspects around Unalaska.
They're a suspected cause for some of the mass deaths we've been seeing, the 10 fin whales that were spotted dead off of Kodiak Island. I know Adak has seen a lot of dead birds. King Cove, I believe False Pass, have been washing up, and we don't know what the causes of that yet either, but in the past, we've seen incidences where sand lance, a little plankton-eating fish, was accumulating these high toxins from these algae in their system. The birds were eating these sand lance, these small forage fish, and were dying. And no one's that I know of is sure yet what happened.
This week, Good has been taking water samples around Unalaska and shipping them off to labs for full analysis. But even just looking in her microscope on Thursday, she found large numbers of the domoic acid algae in one of her recent water samples. She's also sampled the stomach of a stellar sea lion that washed up dead recently on Unalaska's Summer Bay. That's after she shooed away the eagles feasting on the remains.
Well, I didn't see anything external that looked like a cause of death. Sometimes there's gunshot wounds, ship strikes. You know, those things can be very obvious.
She thinks toxic algae might have killed it. A sea lion that washed up dead last year near here had very high levels of PSP. Standing next to this fresh, 10-foot-long carcass, Good says people in the Aleutians should be wary of eating clams or mussels right now.
We just don't know if they're going to be toxic or not. You're taking a lot of risks there.
Crabs don't keep the toxins in their meat, but in their digestive tract. Scientists warn people to remove any dark viscera from crabs before cooking them. Shellfish in King Cove and False Pass recently have tested for twice the level of toxins that the FDA says is safe. Potentially harmful algae are always present in seawater, but it's only when they bloom into dense concentrations that they can cause much harm to the things that eat them. One of the largest harmful algal blooms ever recorded has been taking place this year from California up through British Columbia. Officials in three states have closed beaches to razor clamming and other types of shellfish harvesting. Researchers think the West Coast bloom and recent events in Alaska are related to unusually warm water temperatures. Here's Melissa Good again.
We are seeing large blooms throughout Alaska of different species. When you get warmer water temperatures, they become more prolific. They bloom. You're getting a high concentration of algae.
Good says paralytic shellfish poisoning appears to be getting more common in the Aleutians due to increasing water temperatures. She's waiting for results on her samples for more conclusive answers. In Unalaska, I'm John Ryan.
So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. That's the mainstream report as to what's going on right now. And of course, they blame toxic algae. Again, even if, let's say it is toxic algae, what is suddenly making this stuff so toxic that there's animals that they've admitted in other reports that there's animals that are being affected by this that have never been affected before, and they don't understand why. They don't understand. How about the starfish melting? Where's the answer for that? They're turning into piles of goo. Can you explain? Can you tell me why? Can you tell me exactly why starfish are turning into goo? Can you explain to me that? Last time I checked, when I was a kid, starfish were pretty hard, and they got that texture to them on top. You know, and when they're alive, you can move them around a little bit, but you know what I mean? These things are turning into piles of goo, ladies and gentlemen. That's not normal. Well, it could be because of warmer waters in the Pacific. Well, maybe we should look into tons of radioactive water over the course of 4 years, perhaps heating up the Pacific, at least. Just saying. You know, maybe we should just think about it. Take 5 minutes to think. We can, Fukushima's not a problem. Oh, sure, yeah. Fukushima would never have an effect over the course of 4 years unchecked, right? The problem is most people that look into it think that the Fukushima disaster has been handled and is under control. So they don't take it in, again, compartmentalization, even with knowledge. And these people don't know, and if they don't know, well, then they're not going to take it as, take it into account as maybe a causal factor. So there's that, too. It's not like, well, these people are evil, all these scientists know. No, they probably don't know. It's the easiest way to have somebody do what you want is have them doing it without them even realizing it. So if they're not even thinking about it, they don't even want to think about that. The powers that shouldn't be don't even want these scientists to think about it. So it's not even on their radar, out of sight, out of mind. With that, I want to get to my interview with Leuren. This lady is a fountain of knowledge, ladies and gentlemen. You should go check out her website. It's leurenmoret.info, I believe, if I remember correctly. I'll make sure I double check that while you listen to the interview. Lorenz plugs everything at the end of the interview, all of their social media stuff, where you can email them at the site and everything. So don't worry, any information that you might want to be able to go check her work out further and get in contact with her will be there. And ladies and gentlemen, if you live on the West Coast and you have any type of information about animal die-offs, if you have pictures or video, or you go out and you check the wildlife and you see mutations, take pictures, take video. Contact RadChick on Twitter. It's at RadChick, the number 4, cast. The at symbol, RadChick, the number 4, cast. Send them to her. Email Leuren. Her email info will be at the end of the interview. Their ever going, ongoing research needs to have people like you out there who are willing to go out and take pictures and video and samples and look at stuff and say, hey, look what I found. We need other researchers out there. And if you find something, if you come across something, don't hesitate to reach out to them. That's what they do all day long. They research, and you'd be helping them greatly. So anyway, without further ado, I want to get to the interview with Leuren Moret. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great honor that I introduce you to Leuren Moret, Laurens Battis, and of course, you all know my co-pilot, Christina Consolo, a.k.a. RadChick. Here's the interview with Leuren.
It's really a pleasure. This is our first interview with you. And Popeye, without you and without Christina, this would never have happened. So we have to thank you and the audience for being here, too. I was one of the first women to graduate from the University of California at Davis in 1968 with a Bachelor of Science degree in geology. I also have the equivalent of a master's from Berkeley in wildlife studies. So I understand a lot of I understand how the environment works. And then the PhD research went into off-planet stuff and bigger systems, planetary and universal, the universe. And energy. I mean, it's been really, really interesting. And that's why I did it. I'm curious. I just wanted to know how all this worked. And then I couldn't stop. And then I started meeting people like Christina. And I actually met one of the last living Manhattan Project scientists when I was in Livermore trying to work with the community organization, Tri-Valley Cares, that supposedly was fighting nuclear facilities and nuclear labs. And I did get a job at Livermore in 1989 to 91. And this was just the Cold War winding down and then new systems coming up and the Soviet Union transforming into Russia. And I really was naive. I'd hitchhiked around the world, but I didn't know anything. I didn't know what a nuclear weapon was. I worked there 2 years. I just thought it was a big bomb. They don't want you to know. If they told people what it was really all about, they wouldn't be able to get people to work in the bomb factories to make them. There's like an information blackout there and weird people working there too, mostly people who like to be controlled. I was a single parent living in Livermore. I'd been working there. Then I worked for a private company doing research and development. And I still didn't know what a nuclear weapon was, but I got invited to the plenary to speak at the plenary session of the annual memorial event that lasts a couple of weeks in Japan to remember the tragedy of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Well, I'd never been to the Orient. I got on a plane. All I had was $20. But I said, well, I'm sure I'll survive some way. But of course, the Japanese were wonderful hosts. And I can tell you that was a completely life changing experience. It was so profoundly disturbing what I learned there. And most Americans have not been allowed to know the truth about World War II and about the nuclear weapons dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The first human population to be bombed with nuclear weapons, and it never got into the papers in the U.S. American journalists weren't even allowed in Japan to do any news coverage or anything. So Americans have been very, very bamboozled and deceived by their own government. And in that way, the government was able to turn the whole U.S. into a gigantic nuclear weapons factory. When I was working at Livermore, we were drilling all over the lab to study the radiation. And one day I walked into a laboratory in the environmental department, and there were these big rock cores laying on the tables. And this is where they use drills to drill down into rock formations. And because I'm a geoscientist, I said, well, what are those? And this guy said to me, oh, our environmental team just came back from Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And I said, what are those? Where'd they get those cores? And he said, oh, well, Hiroshima and Nagasaki are still radioactive, and so are the people. We've been studying them since 1945. And I said, what? It's still radioactive? And he said, oh, yeah, it will be for a long time. Well, the half-life of uranium, 238, is 4.5 billion years, the age of the Earth. So all this depleted uranium weapons they've been using all over the world, which I learned about on that trip to Japan, is it's going to take an awful long time for to get rid of this stuff. And all lead is the end product of the decay path of uranium. So all the lead on Earth came from uranium decay. And I can tell you what changed my life. After the memorial ceremony in Hiroshima, and the Prime Minister of Japan even participated, Koizumi, they took us into the Peace Museum. There were 10,000 people there from all over the world. And we went on a tour of the museum, and there were dioramas where people's skin was hanging, you know, a foot or two feet off of their arms. These are dioramas representing what actually happened during and after the bombings. And there was one man standing there in the road with his eyeball in his hand. And I mean, I could not believe what I was seeing. And I made it through the main rooms and the dioramas, and the clock stopped at the time the bomb went off. But when I got to the display case of the nuclear bombs replicas, and there was little boy hanging from the ceiling above us, and I just burst out into tears because I worked in the laboratories where they built those. And I can't tell you how guilty I felt. I felt horrible. And yet the Japanese treated me with completely supreme respect because I was the first American nuclear weapons lab whistleblower who went to Japan and apologized for the U.S. bombing that country.
And if I could mention right now, what Loren was doing at Livermore was a project on attempting to clean up some of the mess that has been made in the quote, peaceful nuclear industry, the Atoms for Peace, the reactors, anyone?
So I ended up doing 20 speaking tours in Japan between 2000 and 2010. I went all over Japan. I saw things that tourists never see. And people told me things. And members of the parliament came to my talks. I worked with the parliament. It was a completely life-changing experience. And I want to tell people in the audience, and you too, Popeye and Christina, when you find something that you can engage with, give your heart and your soul and everything to it, because it is how the human potential comes awake, and the spirituality, the spiritual energy that powers your work is the most liberating. It's the most rewarding thing you'll ever do in your life. And I just don't even know how this happened to me, except that one day I went into that community organization in Livermore, and I saw this 2025 plan, or the 2020 plan of the Air Force, and I went and asked the lady who was running it, is this science fiction or something? And she said, oh, no, they're going to do that. And I said, do you have more of these I can read and take home? And pretty soon I bumped into one of the last living Manhattan Project scientists. He was an old man, and he came in, Marion Falk, and he wanted to teach the community about the danger of tritium, which is radioactive hydrogen, which ends up being radioactive
water.
And I went to him one day. I was heartbroken. I said, the director of this organization said, I can't talk to you anymore, and that I can't use up any more of her time talking to you and educating the public in this organization, in the office, which was for the community. And so I went to him, and I was crying, and I said, she said, I can't talk to you anymore. And he said, oh, really? Well, you'll come to my living room, and we'll do it there. It's better anyway. And so for 10 years, I spent many, many, many hours in that living room, and he taught me the philosophy of science. We didn't sit there and go over books and do calculations, you know. We had discussions. It was like sitting under the tree with Plato every time I went there. And
Socrates, please.
And he said to me, I want you to be my spokesperson to warn people about these technologies. He said, people who work in the nuclear weapons lab knows there's a risk. But he said, that radiation should not get out of the fence and contaminate the public. And so I said, okay. And I just got swept up in it with a complete passion. And I didn't even know what I was doing. I just was doing it. I just got up every morning and I said, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this. And pretty soon I started getting invitations to speak around the world. And so I would call him. I would send him cards. I wanted to keep him alive. I loved him. And he gave me social self-confidence. He gave me scientific self-confidence. And I'm going to tell you something. When men start helping a woman, you better pay attention, because that woman is trying to bring information to the public or trying to do something that the men recognize is very important.
I'm going to pause it right there, ladies and gentlemen, because the top of the hour break is sneaking up on us. I can hear it. Stay tuned. When we get back, I'll rewind it about 2 minutes so you can pick it up with the full context of what she's talking about right now. We'll be back 3 short minutes. My interview with Leuren Moret, Laurens Battis, and of course, the ever lovable Christina Consolo, a.k.a. RadChick. Big shout out and bow to all three of them for the amazing work they all do to enlighten humanity. Stay tuned, ladies and gentlemen. 3 short minutes. We will be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number 2 here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from federaljack.com, popeyeradio.com, and of course, my YouTube archive channel, DTRH Radio Archives. That's Delta Tango Romeo Hotel Radio Archives over on YouTube. Go subscribe to it. Check it out. All of my stuff is there. Anyway, I want to get right back into the interview because it's going to take up pretty much the rest of the second hour here. Talking to Leuren Moret, Laurens Battis, RadChick, a.k.a. Christina Consolo. And when we left off, Leuren was talking about her background, which I wanted her to get into so you guys could get to know her if you don't know who she is. And she was talking about how she ran into and became friends with one of the, I think it was the last surviving member of the Manhattan Project team. So I rewound it to the beginning of that part where she's talking about that, so you have the full context of what she's talking about, where we are when we left off, especially if you're just joining us here in the second hour. I'm going to go back later on in the archives and listen to it. At least you know where we are right now, live, as we're talking. So, without wasting any more time, let's get back to the interview. Here's Leuren.
Pretty soon, I bumped into one of the last living Manhattan Project scientists. He was an old man, and he came in, Marion Falk, and he wanted to teach the community about the danger of tritium, which is radioactive hydrogen, which ends up being radioactive
water
water. And I went to him one day. I was heartbroken. I said, the director of this organization said, I can't talk to you anymore. And that I can't use up any more of her time talking to you and educating the public in this organization, in the office, which was for the community. And so I went to him and I was crying and I said, she said, I can't talk to you anymore. And he said, oh, really? Well, you'll come to my living room and we'll do it there. It's better anyway. And so for 10 years, I spent many, many, many hours in that living room. And he taught me the philosophy of science. We didn't sit there and go over books and do calculations, you know. We had discussions. It was like sitting under the tree with Plato every time I went there. And
Socrates, please.
And he said to me, I want you to be my spokesperson to warn people about these technologies. He said, people who work in the nuclear weapons lab knows there's a risk. But he said that radiation should not get out of the fence and contaminate the public. And so I said, okay. And I just got swept up in it with a complete passion. And I didn't even know what I was doing. I just was doing it. I just got up every morning and I said, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do this and I'm going to do this. And pretty soon I started getting invitations to speak around the world. And so I would call him. I would send him cards. I wanted to keep him alive. I loved him. And he gave me social self-confidence. He gave me scientific self-confidence. And I'm going to tell you something. When men start helping a woman, you better pay attention, because that woman is trying to bring information to the public or trying to do something that the men recognize is very important. And that was my first trip to Japan. I stood there. And that bomb, seeing that bomb in the Hiroshima Museum was the beginning. Then we went to Nagasaki 3 days later for that event, memorial event. And I saw the photos taken within an hour after Nagasaki was bombed by a Japanese photographer. And there was a picture of a young woman with a baby in her arms. Her kimono was blown open and she was nursing her dying baby and her hair was all messed up from the blast. And I started crying and I said, that woman could be me. That woman could be any woman with a baby in the world. What are they doing? And I said, I have to dedicate the rest of my life to this issue, because there's nothing more important. And so here we are today, and it's become much, much worse, much more serious, much more destructive and devastating, and much more demonic than I ever, ever could have imagined when I made that commitment in the Nagasaki Museum. And I will never regret it. It's free-falling through life on the most exciting adventure that I could ever wish for, and I love adventures. Wow, this is it. And it's horrifying. It's terrifying. It's, at the same time, empowering. And it's changing me. It's changing everyone. And so we want to share this information. We want to encourage people to do their own research and to seek the truth, because it's very liberating. It's the happiest thing you can do in your life, for yourself and for humanity, for your family. It is reality. We have to go through it. There's no way out. They've done it to the whole planet. So now I'd like to introduce Laurens Battis III,
So I'm Laurens Lincoln Battis III. Now, I come from a Navy with a family, I should say, with a naval tradition, a very deep naval tradition in point of fact, and one that goes back to very ancient times. The most recent expression of it being my paternal grandfather, who commanded a corvette, an anti-submarine ship, in the North Atlantic in World War I. I went into the Navy after having been part of the successful Vietnam protests, bringing that whole thing to a halt, and then making the mistake of going home thinking that we were finished. It's never over. That's the easiest way of putting it. But I decided to go into the Navy and see, among other things, if there was anything left to salvage while I got the rest of my journalism education. And I went to the Defense Information School at Fort Benjamin Harrison, which was quite an advanced place. It was a free world school. 148 nations participated there. Very large place. And a very high-end place, very high-caliber university. And I got a print journalism degree out of there, and I was invited to stay for additional courses, and I wound up staying for everything, all the way up to and including the closed-circuit television courses, advanced photography, all of those things. And so I came out of the Defense Information School with a very complete journalism degree. I spent 5 years active in the Navy. During that time, we participated in the Iranian hostage rescue attempt. We were one of the support ships up there in the Arabian Sea. So that's who I am.
Let's look at what's going on the West Coast. I'm going to play a news clip for you guys really quick. It's about 2 minutes. It's from King 5 News up in Washington State. And it's about this, what, like I said earlier, I call the Godzilla algae. And after the news clip, Loren and Larry, I would really love to get your take on it. So first, here's the news clip, and then I'll get what you guys think about it. Here we go.
Washington scientists are conducting an emergency survey of an unprecedented toxic algae bloom in the Pacific. The bloom is so big, it extends from Southern California to Alaska. In this video that may be difficult to watch, King 5's Allison Morrow shows us how it's affecting marine life in ways never seen before.
The untrained eye might wonder what's wrong with this sea lion. The video was taken a few weeks ago near Long Beach.
A sea lion with his head arched back and bobbing. He's basically having seizures.
Vera Traynor knows the reason for the seizures. It's in their lab refrigerator, NOAA's Northwest Fisheries Science Center.
There's long chains of different species in here.
They're most concerned about that white one.
This guy here.
It's an algae called pseudonychia.
Each one of these are individual cells and they're joined.
Each cell is microscopic, but with millions together on Washington's coast, they're massively destructive.
So we're seeing effects on the marine ecosystem that we haven't seen before.
The bloom is unprecedented in size, though invisible. It produces a toxin called domoic acid. It's already closed crab and razor clam fisheries. And now its effects are spreading to mammals.
I think it's scary. When we start seeing marine mammals suffering from these toxins, they're not that far in the food chain from us.
NOAA's fisheries scientists have deployed to study it. They're on a ship looking for where the toxic cells are, just how toxic, and what's feeding their growth. With the information, they suspect they may not be able to stop the algae altogether.
But we're able to figure out how to live with them.
Tests of this sea lion showed high levels of domoic acid. It's the first recorded in Washington to react like this. And researchers know it won't be the last.
This is just one animal that was found on the beach. You wonder what other animals that are not on the beaches, what's happening to them.
In Seattle, Allison Morrow, King 5 News.
So, Loren, first you, then Larry, what do you guys think about what they just said about this new Godzilla algae? And I'm doing air quotes because I think it's radiation, but go ahead. What do you guys think?
Well, we've had regular bouts of red tides. That's normal. That's an algae too. And that's that just depends on ocean temperatures and circulation. And I mean, it's very, very complex. And that does make animals sick, and you're not supposed to eat clams and filter feeders and fish and stuff out of water when a red tide historically in the past has arrived. But this is something quite different. And I don't know how far north the red tide normally has traveled in the past, but this doesn't sound right. That's very, very cold water up there. And the red tide is coming from warmer, more central Pacific water. Sounds to me like there are big pulses of radiation released from Fukushima being released now. The whole system is completely out of control.
Larry, what's your take on what's going on in the West Coast with the algae and, like as I said, the Godzilla algae / Godzilla bacteria?
What we have here is something that is short-lived, reproduces rapidly, so it can go through mutations in a rather rapid sequence. It can adapt itself if it's capable of adapting itself. One of the things that's been proven about algae is that it does live in radioactive environments. If you take a look on any of the recent robotic tours of Fukushima while the cameras were still working, one of the things you'll notice is there's algae all over the place. So what we've got is a bioaccumulator in the ocean, and that bioaccumulator is mutating. While it's mutating, it's accumulating radiation. And concentrating it. It's a bioconcentrator of radiation on top of everything else. Is it exuding poison? It might be. It might not be. I have no argument with them if they're finding an exuding poison. It doesn't surprise me at all. Have they told you what the radiation count is on that algae yet? I don't think so. But believe you me, it's hot. Very hot. And the ocean has been dying for quite some time. They're looking high, low, and everywhere for things that they could put on television, feed the media beast, that explain it as something other than radiation. So that's one of the reasons why they're doing that side of the street.
Before I believe that it's actually an algae problem, I would like to have a lot more information because the animals, the sea mammals that are washing up on the shoreline are from all different depths in the ocean. Some of them are very, very deep water, and they would not be eating that algae. They have a different diet. So what is it? And in the last couple of months, since the new year, no, even more recently, this spring in the San Francisco Bay Area, this is 2015, we've had 14 whales wash up dead on the shoreline of the Bay Area, along the ocean side. And they are all ages, and they're all different species, and they're all different sizes. So this has to be an environmental toxin that's killing them. And they also have hair missing. As soon as you see bare patches on cattle, on sea mammals, on people, where all the hair falls out, that's an indicator of radiation exposure. So I believe this is radiation exposure in that they're using the algae story as a cover story. I don't believe that there's algae all over the North Pacific. And also, there's a huge tsunami debris field from the Fukushima disaster that stretches from the coast of China straight across the Pacific to the west coast of the United States. And that is horrendously radioactive. And as Fukushima produces more and more emissions into the air and leaking into the ocean every single day, it's 24 hours a day. It's a Rube Goldberg machine that keeps giving and keeps killing. And there's no way to turn it off. The ocean already is very, very radioactive. And these mammals that were washing up recently are covered with sores. The pups, if they have live pups or the pups are dying, the babies, they're emaciated. There's no food out there in the ocean for them to eat. A lot of them have died from starvation, too. But it's not exactly a simple answer. There are multi-factors, there are multi-vectors, that there are multiplying effects of different combinations. But it's got to be the radiation, because radiation is millions of times more harmful and more toxic than the strongest chemical.
And we've been seeing this die-off, and we've been seeing these patterns of mammals dying, and in some cases, I honestly believe, beaching themselves in protest just to show what's happening to themselves. Honestly, I believe that's happened with certain porpoises. We have photographic evidence of it on our website. All of these things have been going on for a lot longer than the report of this new toxic bloom.
And why isn't anybody reporting? Why isn't the mainstream media anywhere in the world reporting on Fukushima? This is the most important issue in the world today, and there's almost nothing. It's just people like Christina who have the courage to collect samples and to talk to people, and people love her. People appreciate her for the effort she's making. And then you helping her and being there and you know, all of us coming together, we're so lucky to know each other, and for each of us to be doing this work and then complementing each other as we share what we've specialized in. We'll never have enough people to study it all. There's so it absolutely affects everything. So anyone who wants to join us, come on in.
Seriously now, so much to study, so little time.
And now, guys, I'm going to introduce the guest co-host for the evening, because she's been sitting here patiently waiting to talk to you both and say hello to you and then chime in about the Godzilla algae / bacteria over on the West Coast. So let me introduce tonight's guest co-host, Christina Consolo, a.k.a. RadChick. Welcome back, Christina.
Thanks, Popeye, and thanks for getting the show together so quickly. Hi, Loren. Hi, Larry.
Hello, how are you?
Hello. Thank you, Christina.
It's great to be doing radio and talking about Fukushima issues with you again. And you know, as soon as I heard about this monstrous algae bloom, I told Popeye about the interview that that you and I did with Jim Fetzer in October of 2013. And that interview continues to get just heavy, heavy traffic on my YouTube channel, because there's been so much that's happened since then. And I actually went back and I listened to it a few days ago, and Popeye listened to it too. In fact, we're going to play a couple of short clips from that interview, because I'd like for you to hear some of the things that you said in light of what's happening now. So we'll get to that in a little bit. But There's been a few things that really bothered me about this algae bloom, too. And one of the quotes, and I believe it was in the clip that he played earlier. Let me see here. It was from a woman at NOAA, Vera Trainer. She's the manager of the Marine Biotoxin Program at NOAA. And it was reported by the Daily Breeze on June 20th. That what makes this particular algae bloom so unusual is that other debilitating toxins have been found alongside of it, and in some cases, infecting the same animals. And yeah, I started going through, you know, some of the California online papers, and I went to Any News and I started searching through there, and there were just a few things that really stood out. And at the time you and I did the interview with Jim Fetzer, all we were really dealing with at that point were the sick seals in Alaska, the sick walruses, the polar bears that were losing hair and getting lesions, And then we were just at the beginning stages of the starfish epidemic.
Right.
The melting starfish. And at that time, they weren't even really calling it anything yet. They were saying on the news the starfish were turning to goo. And you said that to Fetzer, and Fetzer was like, oh, my God. I mean, that's what he said during this interview. And, I mean, look what's happened since. At the time, this was just happening in a couple places around Vancouver.
Yeah.
Now it's, you know, Washington, Oregon, down all the way down to San Diego, and now it's moved up to Alaska.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they didn't know what was causing it. They didn't, you know, they've been saying all along they didn't know, they didn't know, they didn't know. Now they say that they do know, and it's a virus that's been around for at least 40 years. And the part they can't figure out is why all of a sudden it's affecting all these starfish. So, you know, I'm thinking right away immune system, and so many of the things that have happened to some of the animals, you know, some of the mammals, some of the sea creatures, seems like it could be immune system related. And then I came across a story that was posted in the Laguna Beach, and it's funny, you said you had spent some time or you had lived there as a kid?
Lived there, yeah.
Okay. Tide pool life diminishes, and this was published back in May 10th of 2015. And I'll just read a little bit from this. A virus wiped out sea stars along the entire West Coast last year. This year, an eerie new phenomenon, urchin balding, is attacking purple-spined sea urchins in Orange County tide pools, and local scientists are investigating this new mystery. And, you know, the article goes on to say, you know, it was a warmer winter than usual, you know, and tide pool conditions might be worsening because of that. And, you know, there's all kinds of reasons that are giving pretty much everything but radiation.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we were dealing when we had talked to Fetzer in October of 2013, and we were talking about mostly the sea lions and the polar bears and the walruses and the beginning of the sea stars. You know, now it's abalone, lobster, sea hares, the octopus, small fish, limpets. You know, the sardines have disappeared. The mussels are leaving the tide pools too. We have orcas that can't carry their young to term, and when they do, the babies are stillborn. 100% of the orcas had stillborn or miscarried, you know, because they watch them very closely to see how they're doing in their various habitats. And now, you know, the whales washing up. And right at the beginning, when Fukushima first happened, within a couple of months, I think it might have been June of 2011, they were already finding radioactive whales. And Japan, China, and Russia had all reported that these whales were highly radioactive, which makes sense because whales feed on plankton. And what I know from doing, you know, so many interviews with you and from the work of, like, Paul Langley's nuclear blog is that, you know, the U.S. Army has known since 1955, basically, if not even before that, that plankton bioconcentrates radiation.
I'm going to pause it right there. I'm going to rewind it 30 seconds so you can hear Christina's full comment about plankton and the bioaccumulation of radiation. Stay tuned. Final segment coming up. Don't go anywhere.
U.S. Army has known since 1955, basically, if not even before that, that plankton bioconcentrates radiation at least 1,000 times more than the surrounding seawater. And, you know, everyone's always testing the seawater. Woods Hole wants to test the seawater when they should be testing the plankton. And, you know, somebody did test the plankton. And I found this article on ENE News, dated March 18th of 2012. I had a really hard time finding this. Cesium found in plankton 600 kilometers away from the Fukushima plant. And this, the source of this was the Yomiuri Shimbun newspaper. The radioactivity measurements that they posted found in the plankton 600 kilometers away already in March of 2012 was 56.4 becquerels per kilogram.
Oh my God.
Of dry state plankton. That was cesium-137. In follow-up surveys, they also found cesium-134, which only has a two-year half-life, in plankton at the same levels that they found cesium-137. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that was the highest that they found. And then there was one more publication that was from May 22nd of 2013, and this was from Kyoto. Mm-hmm. Researchers find high cesium in some Pacific plankton. And the levels here were 10.5 becquerels. And that was the last time anyone had tested plankton. And since then, no one has even suggested it. They, of course, never talk about Fukushima anything when it comes to any of the sea life problems, the algae bloom. You know, at least address it and let's rule it out, because it seems pretty obvious when you know that an algae bloom will happen because of like a imbalance in nutrients, like there's a lot of nutrients or fertilizers or runoff or something that will cause algae blooms to form. How do you get an algae bloom that stretches from San Diego to Alaska? You know, what kind of nutrients are we talking here?
It's a cover story.
Yeah.
How did that MOX fuel get into those reactors when the governor of that prefecture had outlawed it? And governors have top command and make all decisions irregardless of what the federal government wants in Japan. The governor is king of his kingdom, and the federal government works with all of them. But they do not tell the governor what to do in his prefecture.
Well, you know, we have social media, too, that can clue us into some of these things when they're happening. And for a while, nosebleed in Japan was like one of their top trending, you know, words. And there was a story that was posted on Any News Today from a nonprofit group that posted some people from Japan, and they said every single person that they hosted had health problems. They had blood stains all over their pillowcases when the people went to like wash their bedding. And one of the moms had said the most of the mothers that she knows from Tokyo and Fukushima have thyroid problems, eye problems, nosebleeds. I mean, after a while, they're not going to be able to cover this up forever when you know. I mean, there's enough people, I think, that are clued into it now, at least there, that you would think they would be avoiding or at least trying to mitigate for certain things in their diet. And you and I had actually talked during the Fetzer interview about some rad readings that were taken off fish that was published by the Vancouver Sun. Mm-hmm. And we're going to play that clip to see what Canadians have been eating.
Yeah, number 9 ties into that too. Back in 2012, the Vancouver Sun reported cesium-137 being found in a very high percentage of the fish that Japan was selling to Canada. 73% of the mackerel tested, 91% of the halibut, 92% of the sardines. Of course, now the sardines from here have disappeared. 93% of the tuna and eel, 94% of the cod and anchovies, and 100% of the carp, seaweed, shark, and monkfish.
100%.
100%, and that is because the levels in these different fish depend on their diet. So fish that prey on other fish usually have lower levels than fish that feed on plankton, for instance, or their bottom feeders, and they pick up mud and small particles, which have higher levels of radiation because of the chemical affinity that tiny particles have for radiation. In other words, very tiny clay particles in water are scavengers for highly charged radioactive particles.
So that was 2012. That was 3 years ago. And, you know, in Canada, because they have the healthcare system, you know, they'll be able to, like, track this through their healthcare system. Mm-hmm. Any kind of disease, and the public will have no access to that unless doctors speak out, which, you know, once in a while they do, but...
At this point, it's really more on the order of dose response testing being done by the Canadian government.
Now, what people don't realize is that nearly 2,000 radioactive isotopes are produced in a fissioning process, and that's what's coming out of burning and coming out of the fuel rods. So you have to multiply that the danger of the cesium they're reporting by almost 2,000 other isotopes. We're getting absolutely bombarded.
We sure have been.
Nuclear technologies and materials are not compatible with life.
Period.
Loren and Larry, we have one more clip that we want to play from the Fetzer interview, and I think this would be a good time to do it. It's about 4 minutes long.
Okay.
If I pick up on number 11, you know, people developing cancer from eating contaminated fish, what I'm stunned by this is that it seems to be having such a rapid effect. I mean, here we have this Daniel Hirsch, a nuclear policy lecturer at UC Santa Cruz, who's telling Global Security Newswire we could have large numbers of cancer from ingestion of fish, and I take it they're already showing up.
It's already showing up.
I mean, how quickly? You know, it's just astonishing that it should be that fast.
Well, you know, part of the problem, too, is that when you look back at Chernobyl, in Japan they're saying right now all these kids that they're finding thyroid problems with, you know, they're developing nodules. Some of them have early cancer. The experts are saying, wow, well, this can't be from Fukushima because it's happening too fast. Because in Chernobyl, it took 4 or 5 years for 100 kids to have cancer.
Well, it's these very tiny particles, and it's constant exposure now for 2 years, more than 2 years. And Chernobyl was just one exposure, and they put the lid on it, they put a sarcophagus on it and stopped it. This is constant daily, 24-hour-a-day releases of low-level and not-so-low-level radiation. And by April of 2011, just 2 months after Fukushima, air samples and air filters in cars were analyzed by Dr. Chris Busby, and he calculated that by April, the radiation concentrations in the air in Japan around the Fukushima area indicated that the equivalent of 300 Chernobyls had occurred. We're talking now, from this new evidence about spherical particles, we're talking about all those fuel rods or large numbers of fuel rods in the cooling pools that are now empty are releasing huge new amounts of extremely toxic sphericals.
Unbelievable.
So it's really bad, and a new study by the food lab and radiation food lab, I believe it's in Japan, they reported that the 19th of October 2013 that Pacific Coast seaweed is contaminated with cesium, and that the levels are 8.14 becquerels per kilo for cesium-134, 8.88 becquerels per kilo for cesium-137, and cobalt is even being reported in seaweed off the Pacific coast of the U.S. At 3.7 becquerels per kilo. In Chiba, which is north, it's between Tokyo and Fukushima, the cesium levels were 41 becquerels per kilo for cesium-134, 63 becquerels per kilo for cesium-137, although no cobalt-60 was detected. But this, there's nothing to compare this to. You can't even compare it to Chernobyl. It's the fuel, the spent fuel rods did not burn at Chernobyl. It was just the reactor rods, and they stopped it right away. But these people in Japan are releasing, they're guaranteeing, they're facilitating increased releases of extremely high levels of radiation on a daily basis into the atmosphere and into the ocean. And of course, contaminated air masses are over here along the Pacific coastline in a matter of days.
This accident isn't over either. No, far from it. They are just kind of doing some cosmetic maintenance, you know, look, keeping the world thinking that they're actually busy over there. They're actually getting something accomplished. The next big thing that was supposed to happen over there was the fuel removal from the pool of reactor 3. And that thing is so destroyed. They said they were going to do it in 3 years, and everybody's like, there's no way. Well, now they're saying 6 years. They can't even get into the building. They can't get a single robot to even function for more than a few minutes.
They can't clean it up, Christina.
I've actually read in the background some of their engineers and things saying they don't even know how they're going to get near it in 6 years, let alone do anything with it. That all that's really going on right now is polite noises are being made in order to push the problem further into the future so it isn't dealt with presently.
That's exactly what they're doing. It's all public relations. Well, there's nothing they can do. There's nothing to store it in that can hold it over a long period of time. There's no way to stop it from leaking and releasing. And they set it all up to have this happen. It was not necessary.
They can't build a robot that's robust enough to even go in there and survive for any length of time to find out just how bad things are, let alone try mitigating them.
No, and this water pouring that's going on will continue, you know, forever at this point. When 400 tons a day is what they say they're pouring, we don't even really know. But I know 4,000 tons a day moves through the groundwater. What comes off the mountains goes through that site because that site was built on an area where there was a riverbed.
Well, so, not only that, they're having underground hydrovolcanic explosions. They're not reporting those either.
And these are the fog events that we see on the cameras. You know, and this accident will not be cleaned up in our lifetimes, in our children's lifetimes, probably our grandchildren's lifetimes. And so, you know, this is kind of where we're at with things.
Christina, I'd like you to take like a minute and just explain to the listeners really quick. And then I would love for Loren and Larry to hop in if they'd like to. I'd like you guys to cover that groundwater thing for a minute, because I don't think people understand that. That's a huge issue. Most people, when they hear water leaking from Fukushima, they think that everybody, I thought this too, they think that, or the thought is that they're referring to, or you guys would be referring to, the water that's coming out of the cooling ponds. And I don't think people understand. You're referring to, there's like 4,000 tons of groundwater that moves, you know, from the mountains down through. And like you said, they diverted this river to build the Daiichi plant right there. So could you can start off, Christina, and then give it to Loren and Larry. Explain a little bit about this. Explain about the 4,000 tons at least of groundwater, because that's the problem, that moves under the ground and then out into the sea.
That's per day, too. By the way, that's per day. And this came from Sean Burney, who's an independent nuclear consultant who was interviewed by RT like 2 years ago. And he had brought this up. And, you know, this ran on RT, so I know a lot of people saw it. And yet every nuclear expert that I have seen interviewed since totally ignores this groundwater issue. But because we have the melted cores, in three buildings that are now, you know, through the reactor buildings, they burned through the concrete probably within the first few hours or, you know, in the first few days maybe. And now this groundwater that goes through the site is pouring into the Pacific. And the water that they're pouring on the fuel, the melted fuel, into those reactor holes is going into trenches and the basements. So that's
there isn't any fuel in the reactors. It was all in the basement and burned through the floorboard within a day or two.
And now, you know, all this has been pouring into the Pacific for over 4 years, every day, this much radioactive water. And oh my goodness, we have the largest algae bloom ever in the history of the ocean. That the scientists are saying this is why the seals are having seizures, and this is why the pups are being abandoned, and this is why, you know, everything was losing its fur and its spines, and everything's sick and everything's dead. You know, it's,
yeah, that's
algae bloom bullshit. It's because of what's been pouring into the Pacific for over 4 years now.
This is the propaganda that is being fed via the controlled media to the consuming public in the United States. That's correct.
Because when you ingest algae that has toxic substances in it, it damages the liver. The liver processes all those toxins and neutralizes them and protects the body. But it doesn't make the hair fall out and conjoined twins and the spine to fall apart and see the starfish to melt. This is definitely a cover-up of nuclear events that are out of control at Fukushima, but they have to say something to the public and they have to lie. So I don't believe anything TEPCO says, nothing that General Electric says. And I sure don't believe most of what our government says either.
We're going to do future interviews about the Wigner effect and how the aviation industry may be affected by this, the contamination of the air column, which is now all the way up to lower orbital space.
And, yes.
You know, we had a SpaceX rocket that blew up today. Another one. This is on
third time.
Antares rocket that blew up 3 or 4 months ago. And we had the Virgin Galactic rocket that also blew up. You know, and wheels are falling off planes and landing in people's kitchens in Quebec. And I mean, every day there's something crazy. And the people are like, don't they do safety checks? Like, how can a wheel just fall off a plane and go through an apartment building?
And there have been a lot of accidents on roller coasters. And then I had messages from Canada around the Toronto area. Ski lifts just stopped working. They had damage from the Wigner effects. And the skiers were trapped in the air for 4 or 5 hours waiting to get for the repair to happen. And also Putin is creating a whole new military aircraft and other equipment industry in Russia. He has to, because they were relying on Ukraine for most of their equipment. And there are new planes being designed, and they have a plastic coating, some special coating, on all the surfaces of the plane, on the outside of the plane. So it is changing and transforming the airline industry, and it's very important to follow that, because you get confirmation that it is a problem and what kinds of solutions they're using, and then what are the geopolitical aims and outcome? What is the benefit, or who's making money on this scam? This is just an ongoing problem that with unintended consequences that just is never going to die.
Well, there's no shortage of material to do future radio shows, just on the radiation aspect alone. And we'll keep on this algae bloom situation, too.
Well, we have to. There are very few people reporting
the
on it.
The death of the oceans is the real story.
Well, yeah, because that's where, like, a large amount of our food comes from. And it's amazing how many people in this country do not pay attention to what's going on at all. They don't worry about They'll worry about it when all the food is dying off and there's nothing left to eat but, like, pine cones and tree bark and each other. Well, then maybe they'll care about it. Guys, I want to thank the two of you for giving us so much time tonight to talk about Fukushima and radiation and everything else and get into detail about this because, you know, like you guys just both stated, nobody's talking about the sea life being poisoned, the oceans being poisoned. And, Loren, you made a comment, and, you know, we can end with this, but you made a comment in that interview with Fetzer 2 years ago that I find highly disturbing. That it was something to the effect of by 2020, the entire Pacific will be irradiated. And that's a really sobering thought, especially understanding what you were talking about earlier with the underground, well, not underground, but underwater river, you know, that current that moves around the entire planet from, you know, different spot to different spot, you know, like down here in southern Florida and all the way up through the East Coast. It's called the Gulf Stream. So,
right.
And that connects into the rest of this huge river. So if all that connects, eventually the Pacific is going to bleed out into everything else.
Yes,
it does. Exactly.
It already has. And it's called the Great Conveyor Belt.
Right around the world.
It's the whole world. It's the whole planet.
Loren, Larry, I want to thank the two of you so much for taking all of this time tonight. And the listeners, I know you guys won't really appreciate the sacrifice that Loren and Larry made today for us by coming and talking to us, because a lot of this will be edited down to fit into 2 hours, but it's about a 4-hour interview in total so far. I just want to thank the two of you for taking so much time out of your day. I know you two are very busy. You know, you spend a lot of time during the course of the day, the two of you, doing research, and then you're like normal humans. You also have your own lives. So I really do appreciate this, and I know Christina does as well. So thank the two of you. Thank you from, like, the bottom of my heart, the bottom of the listeners' hearts, and from Christina. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. It's been a really, really very nice interview. Very nice. You're a very, very good host, and Christina also. Popeye, you're very, very, very good interviewer. Very, very good. You have a beautiful voice. You have a great sense of timing, and you let the people talk and get the information and everything out. It makes the interview really fun and really, really more spontaneous. That the audience likes that better, too.
Yeah, you've got a very good sense of what the right question is to ask next.
Yeah,
thank you.
Your fingers on the pulse. You know what's going on. You're in control. It's a very nice interview. I just thank you for helping us get the information out, and we're looking forward to hopefully more interviews in the future. So thank you very much.
Yes. Popeye, I wanted to thank you, and I wanted to thank RadChick for having us on, for having us here for this interview. We do appreciate the opportunity and the variety of venues that we get out onto, and our friends who are serious about this. As far as websites go, yes, please, by all means, do visit LeurenMoret.info. That's LeurenMoret.info. A fast way of finding it by Google search is LM:GNC, which is our short signature, Leuren Moret Global Nuclear Cover-Up.
It's very user-friendly, it's very informative, and of course, our intent is to educate the public. It's not entertainment, it's actual, real information that people need and they want. Write to us, Leuren Moret at LeurenMoret.info.
Or contact.
At
LeurenMoret.info.
Yes.
Thank you two so much. And thank you for all the work you guys do.
thank you, and thank Christina, and you're wonderful people. It's wonderful to know you, and we really appreciate what both of you are doing. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Lynn. Thanks, Larry.
You're most welcome, Christina. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's it. As I always tell you, the solutions to our problems are most definitely an inside job. We will figure this out. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. Do not give up. Hold the line. I love you all, and I will catch you all again live next week. I am out of here.